For any of our viewers in the US, the term diesel almost always refers to something like a Cummins, a Detroit, John Deere, International, Ford, GM, and so on. Diesel engines are popular in heavy-duty applications in the US, but not small applications like standard road cars, which is in stark contrast to many other parts of the world, where diesel cars are very popular for their fuel efficiency and reliability. For that simple reason, the BMW M57 diesel engine has almost completely flown under the radar over the last decade or so here in the US. Plain and simple, many enthusiasts just don't even know about it, and that includes me. I know companies like Volkswagen make really popular little diesel engines, but I had no idea anybody offered something so performance oriented like the M57. And on top of that, the BMW M57 doesn't just have a lot of performance, it also has a ton of reliability, it's super strong, it's just plain and simple an amazing little engine that most of us just don't know about. With that being said, it's time we take a deep dive into the BMW M57 diesel and see just what makes it so special. While the BMW M57 is generally referred to as the 3-liter diesel engine that you'll find in applications like the 335D and the E9X BMW platform, it's actually more than just that 3-liter engine. In fact, there are 5 generations of this engine in total, with 3 different displacements and a ton of changes in between, including design and construction materials. These different versions include the M57D25, the M57D25TU, the M57D30, M57D30TU, and the M57D30TU2. The first two have a displacement of 2.5 liters, with power output ranging from 148 horsepower to 174 horsepower. The third engine is a 3-liter, although really it's much closer to a 2.9 liter and is generally referred to as a 2.9 liter, and it has power outputs ranging from 181 horsepower to 190 horsepower. And the last two versions are a true 3-liter, with power outputs ranging from 194 horsepower to 282 horsepower. The most performance-oriented version of the M57 and the most popular version, the version that we're most familiar with here in the US, is the M57D30TU2 Top, with a power output of 282 horsepower and 428 pound-feet of torque. And more importantly than that, this is the only version of the M57 of all these iterations. This is the only one that came with an aluminum cylinder block rather than a cast iron cylinder block. Cast iron is pretty standard for a diesel engine, as it's cheaper and quite a bit stronger, which is important for a diesel engine, which is generally going to vibrate a ton compared to a gasoline engine, as well as produce significant amounts of low-end torque. Plain and simple, iron is the better material when it comes to strength. But considering the applications for this high performance version of the M57, the switch to aluminum makes sense. In a car like the 335D, you're probably not going to want a really heavy 3-liter diesel engine with a cast iron block in the front of it. That's going to make the car really nose heavy. So if you switch to an aluminum block, it's going to save a ton of weight and help the car feel more balanced. Starting from the top down, we're looking at an aluminum 4-valve cylinder head with dual overhead cams. And as you can see here, the cylinder head is bolted to the block with 4 head bolts per cylinder. For heavy duty applications, many enthusiasts prefer 6 head bolts per cylinder, like you'll find on the B series Cummins, International DT466, and so on. But for this application, 4 bolts per cylinder is more than strong enough, especially considering their 12 millimeter diameter, which really helps keep the cylinder head clamped hard onto the block, even up to 75 psi of boost pressure without stretching the head bolts, which is quite impressive. For reference, something like the 6-liter power stroke that Ford used in their F-Series trucks, that was built by International, and that has 4 head bolts per cylinder, and that's a good example of why it's a bad thing, because there's a lot of head bolt stretching in that application. Granted, part of that whole problem with the 6-liter is the torque to yield head bolts, but the point is still stands, that 4 bolts per cylinder is not the preferred layout for a diesel engine. Inside the high performance version of the M57's aluminum block, there's a strong forged steel crankshaft that's bolted in place by 2 main bolt caps, and more importantly, the rest of the rotating assembly is massively overbuilt. You know, a lot of people talk about the N54 as the modern 2JZ because it's massively overbuilt, it can take all this power in stock form, you can just slap on a big turbo, leave stock internals, and it's just fine. But what if I told you the M57's connecting rods are quite literally twice as thick as the N54's? The M57's insanely beefy connecting rods are then paired with cast aluminum direct injection pistons with steel ringlands, and the engine is topped off with a composite intake manifold. manifold. In terms of power potential, the M57 is an incredibly capable engine, arguably more capable than the N54 at making big power. The only weak point on the M57 that needs to be modified in order to withstand big power is the valve springs, as they can't really hold high RPM or high boost pressure. As mentioned earlier in the video, on the front of the engine, we have a chain to drive the camshafts rather than a belt. While a chain is superior to a belt-driven system in terms of reliability, most diesel enthusiasts would prefer to see a fully gear-driven system, like we see on heavy-duty diesel engines. But at the end of the day, this engine is not a semi-truck engine, and it's not something like a Cummins engine that's meant to do a million miles, so a chain-driven system is more than good enough. The important part of this high-performance version of the M57 that makes it so popular, that makes it so powerful and so capable, is the OEM sequential turbocharger setup that is comprised of two BorgWarner turbochargers. The small unit is a K39, which is very small and responsive, giving the M57 loads of low-end power. The larger unit is a K26, which comes alive at high RPM and works alongside the K39 to provide maximum power output. It's also worth noting that different versions of the M57 use different turbo setups, and the aforementioned sequential turbo system applies specifically to the M57 D30 TU2 top. That unique turbocharger setup allows the M57 to produce upwards of 400 horsepower and 600 pound-feet of torque with bolt-ons and tuning. As with any diesel engine, the injection system is massively important to reliability, fuel efficiency, and most importantly, power. And this is another area where BMW really knocked it out of the park. And what I mean by this is that they just went straight to Bosch and they used their Cp3 injection pump. That's right, the BMW M57 is equipped with the exact same Bosch Cp3 injection pump that you'll find on the 6.7 Cummins and tons of Duramax engines. Well, that's only partially true. The M57's Cp3 injection pump is the R70 model, which is a different version from the Cp3 found on the larger Duramax and Cummins engines. But the point still remains. This injection pump is capable of producing 23,200 psi of injection pressure, and it's paired with fast-firing multi-event piezoelectric injectors. For a high-performance M57 build, tuners will generally add a secondary Cp3 injection pump to support larger injectors, and that kind of setup will generally be good for just under 700 wheel horsepower and 1,000 pound-feet of torque. It is worth noting, though, that older versions of the M57 do not use performance-oriented injectors. They don't use piezoelectric injectors at all. And unfortunately, as with pretty much every single modern diesel engine, the M57 is equipped with every single emissions component that we love to hate. These include the diesel oxidation catalyst, diesel particulate filter, selective catalyst reduction with diesel exhaust fluid, and exhaust gas recirculation. As compared to many other diesel engines, these components can be fairly reliable, with the exception of the SCR and DEF system, which is well documented as a source of headaches and problems on the M57. Of course, there are emissions delete kits available on the market for the M57, as there are with pretty much any single diesel engine, as these parts are literally the least reliable part of this diesel engine, but it's not road legal, so make sure you don't use it on the road. Outside the emission systems, the only real weak point you'll find on the M57 are the flappers in the intake manifold. Each port is equipped with a plastic flap that's supposed to improve fuel efficiency, but because it's plastic, it will degrade with time. When this happens, you can and likely will see very large chunks of plastic flying into your cylinders, and rather obviously, that's going to cause some problems. The ideal scenario is to delete these plastic flaps before they become a problem, especially if you're in the pursuit for performance, as increased boost pressure and heat can accelerate the timetable of which the plastic degrades and eventually explodes. And that brings us all the way around to the applications and the platforms that the M57 is used in, and more specifically why the 335D is actually a better option than the 335i for many prospective BMW buyers. Just think about it for a second. The N54 is well known for being incredibly reliable. Sure, it has a ton of power potential, whereas the M57 still has a ton of power potential and it's significantly more reliable on top of getting significantly better fuel economy. Sure, you might not get the raw performance that you could from an N54, but it's pretty close. Unfortunately, the only downside with the 335D is that it was never offered with a dual clutch transmission like select 335 N54 models and N55 models. That being said, the ZF6 transmission in the 335D certainly isn't a bad thing in any way. In fact, it's quite capable of withstanding big amounts of power, but the slow upshifts and even slower downshifts leave a lot to be desired compared to the 7-speed DCT. Of course, that opinion on the transmission will vary widely depending who you ask, but regardless, it's hard to argue that the 335D is not a viable alternative to the 335i. With some modifications and tuning, you can very easily get a 335D to run a 12-second quarter mile while still getting 30 to 40 miles per gallon. That's pretty hard to argue with as not being an amazing streetcar. So while the US majorly lacks on the diesel car front as compared to pretty much any other country, the BMW M57 is a glimpse of what we could have if we adopted diesel cars en masse. The performance is great, the tunability is nearly on par with the N54. The reliability is superb, especially for a BMW product, and fuel efficiency blows BMW gas engines out of the water. In the US, we almost exclusively see diesel engines used in trucks, something like a Ram truck or a GM truck or Ford Super Duty. And while the M57 is way different than any of these engines, it certainly deserves recognition as a well-designed and very powerful little engine. And it represents what German diesel engines are capable of as compared to American diesel engines. If you think there's anything I forgot to add or anything you want to add to this, be sure to drop it down in the comments below. While you're down there, let me know what else you want to see in the future. Smash the thumbs up button if you enjoyed the video. Get subscribed so you don't miss out on future videos. Check out some of the other stuff on the channel. Follow us on Instagram and TikTok, and I'll see you guys in the next one.